Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, dear friends and colleagues and our students from different countries. I am Professor Dr. Sayyid Amir Gilani, Chairman of Afro-Asian Institute of Medical Sciences, Lahore, Pakistan, and Dean of Faculty of Allied Health Sciences at University of Lahore in Pakistan. Today we are going to have a free webinar on a very important topic, which is the basics of echocardiography. Our invited speaker is Associate Professor Dr. Muzaffar Ali, who is FCPS Medicine, FCPS Cardiology, and he is Consultant Interventional Cardiologist. We are very lucky to have him, and I hope the students will learn a lot from this lecture. So I invite Professor Dr. Muzaffar Ali to start his presentation on basics of echocardiography. Sir, mic is to you.
Thank you very much, Professor Amir. I'm really a great privilege and very happy to have this opportunity. And today we are going to have the basic concept of echocardiography. As he introduced me, I'm Dr. Muzaffar Ali, Associate Professor of Cardiology at Allama Iqbal Medical College and Jinnah Hospital, Lahore. And I am basically an interventional cardiologist, but at the same time, I'm a very qualified echocardiographer. So basic echocardiography, general principle of ultrasound also apply on the echocardiography, because echocardiography is basically ultrasound of the heart. Is a type of the ultrasound test that uses high pitched sound waves to produce an image of the heart. So the transducer, actually this is the transducer, which transform the echo mechanical energy into an electrical signal, which is processed and displayed as an image on the screen. So this is the image of the heart basically. So this is actually the sound waves basically which produce this image. The principle is the same as the as that of the ultrasound. So this picture is showing a gentleman is doing echocardiography of a patient, and just look at the position of the patient. He is lying in lying position, left lateral position, and patient lies on the bed on left side, and sonographer moved the transducer on the patient chest. This is the apex of the patient, and this is the basic diagram showing how echo is done and where the patient lies and what is the position of echocardiographer in fact. So there are different views where we can attain the anatomy of a heart, like left peristinal view, apical view, subcostal view, and the right peristinal view. And similarly, the transesophageal echocardiography at different planes, different angles, we actually target the different structures of the heart, and after that, the pathology of the heart. So transthoracic echo basically is also known as transthoracic echocardiogram, TTE abbreviated, is the cardiac ultrasound, and the subject is asked to lie in the semi-recumbent position on his or her left side with the head elevated, and the left arm is tucked under the head, and the right arm ties lies along the right side of the body. As we have shown you the picture, the standard position on the chest wall are used for placement of transducer called echo window. So here are the different position where we put the transducer. Like this is the first left peristinal view between the second and third intercostal space and left sternal edge. So this is left peristinal view, then we rotate clockwise for short axis. And here is the apex when we have to attain the apical four chamber view. And here is the subcostal view when we have to look for the interatrial septum or pericardial flam. This is the epigastric window. And here is the suprasternal view, actually when we have to look for the different pathologies, arch of aorta or persistent ductus arteriosus. This is the typical view we have to attain, suprasternal view. So this is again the diagrams and showing the different view positions for different window. This is suprasternal window, and this is the left peristinal view and window, and this is the apical four chamber view, and here is the subcostal view. So peristinal long axis view, the first view actually when we are doing the echocardiogram, So we do, there are a lot of information we can pick. So because first impression is the last impression, this is the illustrated picture, heart, this is the right ventricle, this is left ventricle, this is the aortic valve, this is aorta, and here lies the left atrium. And left atrium opens through the mitral valve into left ventricle. There are the mitral valve structure, a mitral valve cordae, and then the papillary muscle attached. And this is the real image we actually make when we do the left parasternal view at second intercostal space, left sternal edge, and the transducer angle is facing the right shoulder. So this is actually the aortic valve, aortic LVOT, left ventricle outflow tract. This is a right ventricle. Here is the interventricular septum. And this is the mitral valve. This is anterior mitral leaflet. This is posterior mitral leaflets. And this is left ventricle. So this is the first way we actually can have the idea of mitral valve diseases, aortic valve diseases, and at the same time, the left ventricle ejection fraction or function is also assessed at the septum and posterior wall, whether it's contracting or not. So this is the first view, left parasternal long axis view. Then comes to the short parasternal short axis view. So just at the left parasternal second intercostal space, we just rotate the transducer clockwise, slightly clockwise, and so that the mark of that very transducer points toward the left shoulder, that is 90 degree clockwise from parasternal long axis view. So by tilting the transducer, we can attain this view, and this is for the aortic valve abnormality. Just look, this is the aortic valve, Mercedes sign. There we can see the different cusps of the aortic valve, left coronicus, right coronicus, non-coronicus. At the same time, we can have idea of interatrial septum. This is the interatrial septum. This is left atrium. Between the right atrium and left atrium is interatrial septum. Here is the tricuspid valve, and this is right ventricle outflow tract, and here lies the pulmonary valve. And if there are the pathologies of pulmonary valve, like pulmonary stenosis, pulmonary regurgitation, we can have idea on this view. So this is illustrated pictures. So this is the left sternal short axis view, the second view we attain. Then we actually cut the LV at different level. If we have to see at the basal level, then we have to rotate the probe clockwise. And this at the there are different actually pictures we attain. This is illustrated picture, the left ventricle at the papillary level. This is the anterolateral papillary muscle, and this is the posteromedial papillary muscle. That means that we are at the mid left ventricle level. This is anterior wall, this is the posterior wall, this is septal wall, this is the lateral wall, this is right ventricle. So this is at the papillary muscle level. So this is apical four chamber view. So apical four chamber view, basically we put the probe at the apex level, and then the point of the transducer is facing toward the axilla, and we can attain this view. So here we see the all chamber of the heart, like left ventricle, right ventricle, and then the left ventricle and left atrium. In between there is mitral valve, and between the right ventricle and the right atrium there is a tricuspid valve and interventricular septum. This is LV, RV, and in between there is a left interventricular septum, and between left atrium and right atrium is the interatrial septum. So look at this, is the so important view. Okay, we can see the anatomy of mitral valve, tricuspid valve, right ventricle, left ventricle, and we can have idea of the different pathologies of the mitral valve, tricuspid valve, pathology of the left ventricle, right ventricle. There is a left ventricle disease, like if there is a myocardial infarction, we can have idea of the contraction of the left ventricle, because this is the septal valve and this is the lateral valve, this is the apical valve. So at the same time, this is the important view. We can put, if there is myocardial infarction, we can also have idea of the left ventricle clot. If there are masses or clot in the left atrial apex, we can have idea in this view. This is a very, very important view. So this is the typical illustrated picture. Look, this is the mitral valve, tricuspid valve, cordae, and then the papillary muscle, and the left atrium. Between left ventricle and left atrium is the mitral valve, and this is the tricuspid valve. So this is a very important view. At the same time, we can also have the idea of the structural or congenital heart disease in this view. If there is a ventricular septal defect, then there we can have the echo dropout of interventricular septum. And similar, if there's a left interatrial septal defect, then we can have the idea of echo dropout of interatrial septum. So congenital heart disease, valvular heart disease, left ventricle diseases related to myocardial infarction or ischemic heart disease or cardiomyopathies, and left ventricle apical clot are very well picked by this view. This is very important view. We call it apical four-chamber view. So then in the apical two-chamber view, we rotate the transducer toward the right side and we attain this view. Here we actually look the two-chamber left atrium and left ventricle, and the wall which is facing anteriorly is anterior wall and the posterior is the infraposterior wall. So at the mitral well level, we can call it the inferior wall also. So this is the true picture. This is illustration, anterior wall, this is inferior wall. So this is important view. If a patient come to us with myocardial infarction, we can have idea that this is anterior wall MI or inferior wall MI. If anterior wall MI, this wall will be moving less. If the inferior wall MI, this wall will be moving less. So this is classically two-chamber view. At the same time, we can also have the idea of the mitral valve disease, like if patient mitral valve snows or regurgitation. So we can have idea through this. So this is the subcostal view. Sometimes patient are poorly echogenic, like a patient come to you, he is COPD patient or asthmatic patient. Due to the hyperinflation of the lung, we can't make the good window by doing the transthoracic echo. So for that, we have to attain the subcostal view, epigastric view. We put the probe at the epigastrium, and then we can have the idea of the left ventricle, right ventricle, interatrial septum. So this, classically, this view is meant when you have to look the interatrial septum while ASD, atrial septal defect cases, or there is a pericardial ischemia, we can have the idea of the pericardial ischemia. And when we have to drain the pericardium, so this is the best view. We can actually measure the length where our needle should be in the pericardium. So at the same time, we can also have the idea of left ventricle function in this view. This is the apical, this is all the subcostal four chamber view or epigastric view. So this is the suprasternal view. We put the transducer at suprasternal node, and we can have the idea of aortic arch. This is aortic arch. This is ascending aorta. This is the aortic arch where this brachiocephalic vessel and subclavian vessel arise, and this is the descending aorta. So in this view, actually, the idea of doing this view is some anomalies are best picked by in this view. If there is coarctation of aorta, like here is the coarctation of aorta, then we can pick the coarctation of aorta. Similarly, there is the coarctation post-ductal after the origin of persistent ductus arterius, so we can pick. Similarly, the aortic aneurysm or aortic dissection is very well picked by this view. The aortic dissection is extending to aortic arch and involving the descending aorta, we can have idea in this view. And plus, if their patient have persistent ductus arteriosus, then we can have this view, which is very helpful. By suprasternal view, we can make the anatomy as well as pathology through this view. So if you look at the modalities of echo, so there are conventional 2D echo where we can actually give the anatomical detail of the LV function. At the same, there are, if we have to look for the function of the left ventricle, like ejection fraction, where it's very important, okay, what is the ejection fraction of the patient? What is the LV function? When we put the M mode echocardiography, and if we have to check the patient valves are functioning properly, whether they are valves are stenosed or regurgitating, like mitral regurgitation, mitral stenosis, aortic regurgitation, tricuspid stenosis, tricuspid stenosis, the pulmonary regurgitation, pulmonary stenosis, then we take the help of Doppler echocardiography. And continuous wave Doppler is actually a modality which gives you the velocity across the stenosed valve And the similarly pulse wave Doppler is also the Doppler where we can measure the velocity. And the similar the color flow, when we put the color, then we can have the idea of regurgitation, whether it's a mild regurgitation, whether it's a moderate, whether it's severe. So Doppler echo actually is help us in detecting the regurgitation or stenotachlean. And at the same time, they also help us in calculating the severity of the stenotic or regurgitation. So this is the M-mode echocardiography. There is an M-mode on echocardiography machine. Just pressing that button, we can have the measurements of the aorta and left atrium and left ventricle. This is the left ventricle interior septum, this is left ventricle posterior septum, and this is the systole and this is diastole. By measuring the length of diastole and systole, we can have the ejection fraction. So this is the M-mode echocardiography is basically help us in measurement of the cardiac dimension and motion patterns. So similarly, this is the Doppler echocardiography. As I have mentioned, this is the CW continuous wave Doppler and across the aortic valve, and this is the high pressure signal. And this the velocity, by measuring the velocity, we can have idea whether the stenosis is severe or mild. And similarly, the color flow, let's look at this picture. This is the apical four chamber view. This is left ventricle, left atrium, right ventricle, right atrium. And this is the turbulence across the mitral valve, basically showing the severe regurgitation. The blood from left ventricle, instead of going into aorta, comes back into left atrium. That means it is regurgitation. So similarly, the right ventricle blood is going from right ventricle normally into right ventricle outflow and then the pulmonary circulation. But instead of going into left right ventricle outflow, if it comes back into right atrium, that means it is regurgitation. So we can pick the regurgitated lesion in by doing the Doppler echocardiography. The color flow, different colors are used to designate the direction of the blood flow. The red flow is toward the probe and blue is flow is away from the transducer. But when there is a turbulence that show a mosaic pattern, that means there is abnormal, whether it is a stenotic valve or a regurgitant valve. So conclusion, echocardiography provides a substantial amount of structural and functional detail because we are not only looking for the structure of the heart, but also the functional abnormalities also. So structural like ASD, atrial septal defect, ventricle septal defect, like mitral stenosis, regurgitation is for functional, and functional capacity of the heart is assessed by taking the ejection fraction, like left ventricle function in cases of myocardial infarction or cardiomyopathy. So just to summarize the previous lecture, if we can just recap our knowledge, then this is the left left lung axis view, left parasternal lung axis view, where we can look the right ventricle, left ventricle, interior septum. This is the aortic valve. This is the mitral valve. And this is the short axis view at the mitral valve level. And this is the basal lateral valve. This is the basal septal valve. This is the anterior valve. This is the basal posterior valve. And here is the mitral valve. If patient mitral valve is stenosed, we can take the mitral valve area. This is anterior mitral leaflet. This is posterior mitral leaflet. Here are the commissure. We can have idea of the mitral valve, whether it is stenosed or not. If it is stenosed, it is tight or mild or moderate, because we can calculate the area through this view. This is the short axis view at the mitral valve level. This is the short axis view at the papillary muscle level, at the mid LV level. So we attain this view when there is myocardial infarction, and we have to just indicate whether it's mid or apical septum or posterior wall or lateral wall is moving less or not. And this is the short axis view at the apical chamber view, where we can have the idea of apical anterior wall, apical lateral wall, apical inferior wall. This is the apical septal wall. So similarly, this is the two chamber view. We can have the idea of basal anterior, mid anterior, apical anterior, and similarly apical inferior, mid inferior, basal inferior. There are the different segments of the heart, and we can have idea what segment is involved and what segment is moving less, so we can diagnose it. So similar the four chamber view. This is the picture of the left peritoneal view, again summarizing and giving you the hint. This is left peritoneal view. This is aortic valve, mitral valve, and interventricular septum, posterior wall, and this is the right ventricle. So if you just, this is an again the left peritoneal view showing anterior and posterior wall. This is the short axis view, left peritoneal view at the short, at aortic level, short axis. So we can have idea of interatrial septum. This is left atrium, right atrium. This is tricuspid valve, right ventricle, and here is the pulmonary valve. And then comes to the, this is the short axis view at the mitral valve. This is the real image of the patient, and this is the mitral valve. This is the normal mitral valve. It's open valve, open valve. Normally the mitral valve area is 4 to 6 centimeters square, and this is the normal valve. In stenosed valve, you will have a fish mouth appearance, and valve will be stenosed. And this is the left ventricle short axis view of the mitral valve area, and we can have the idea of anterior wall, posterior wall, lateral wall, septal wall, kinesis function through this view. Similarly, this is again a real image of the patient showing a left ventricle short axis view at the papillary muscle level. This is the anterolateral papillary muscle, this is posteromedial papillary muscle, and this is the lateral wall at the mid LV level, septal wall, anterior wall, and this is the posterior wall. So we can have idea of function of different segment, and we can diagnose myocardial infarction, whether it's a lateral wall MI, this wall will be involved, the posterior wall MI, this wall will be involved, the septal, anteroseptal wall MI, this wall will be moving less. If the anterior wall MI, this wall will be moving less. This is the apical four chamber view, classical LV, right ventricle, mitral valve, tricuspid. How can you can judge this is mitral or tricuspid? So tricuspid valve is apically displaced. So almost 4 millimeter or 4 to 8 millimeter distal toward the apex. So this is the, toward the apex, that means this is tricuspid valve. This is mitral valve. So this is a two chamber view, again anterior wall and inferior wall showing anterior wall. This is the subcostal view, summarizing the key features of the normal echo views, echo windows. This is the apical four chamber. This is subcostal window. We can also call it the epigastric window. So our probe is in the epigastrium. This is the chamber, is if just adjacent to the liver is the right ventricle, and in between is the interventricular septum, then the left ventricle, and the chamber distal the mitral and tricuspid valve. This here is the interventricular septum between the left atrium and right atrium. This is the tricuspid valve. This is the mitral valve. So we can also have the idea of pericardial effusion here. If there is the echo, there will be echo free space between the heart border and the liver. So there are different valve lesion, like the Bernoulli principle and continuity equation will be used in coming lecture when we will have the lecture on the disease valve. So we can calculate the aortic valve area and severity of aortic stenosis by application of this continuity equation, which is actually aortic one area and velocity aortic at the aortic one area and velocity at the aortic valve, and distal to the stenotic, what is the aortic valve area and what is the velocity area. So we can calculate the aortic area through this continuity equation. So this is the typical aortic stenosis mosaic pattern when we put a color Doppler at across the aortic valve. So continuous wave across the aortic valve, we can have this signal across the continuous wave. So here we can actually, this is actually velocity, increase velocity across the aortic valve, we can calculate the stenosis of the severity of the stenosis by doing the color continuous wave Doppler. If the velocity or pressure gradient is more than 80 peak and more than 40 millimeter of mercury mean, that means a severe aortectinosis. So similarly, pulse wave Doppler across the left ventricle outflow tract also help us in detecting the aortic valve area. So this is beyond the scope. Today we are our intention is to go for the normal echocardiography, basic thing. So transesophageal echocardiography is another modality. Sometimes patient are very obese or poorly echogenic. You are transthoracic echocardiography, can't pick the findings. We can do the transesophageal echocardiography where the camera is attached to the probe and which is in the mid-esophagus level and directly takes the picture of the heart. And similarly, if there is a left atrium clot or mitral prosthesis, or we have to pick the vegetation and infective endocarditis, we use this modality. And similarly, in atrial septal defect, sometimes we can't detect the different atrial septal defect. So this modality is especially helpful. And when we have to diagnose the atrial septal defect and when we have to close the atrial septal defect through the device closure. So this is transesophageal echocardiography. So we actually put the probe through the esophagus and then camera detects, capture the picture of the heart. So advantage and disadvantage of the patient if they have dysphagia, kyphoscoliosis, INR is more than 4, bleeding tendency, we avoid this. But the this is very important image actually in patient who have aortic dissection or infective endocarditis when you have to pick the vegetation or masses or clot in left atrium. When you are going for PTMC before PTMC, we assess the mitral valve and we also look for the clot. So we have to perform this transesophageal echocardiography, very helpful. Indeed. So complication of the stress echocardiography is another modality. So the patient who can't do the exercise tolerant test, like obese patient or fracture patient, if we have patient a fracture and we have to assess whether patient is ischemic or not, then we can do the stress echocardiography by dobutamine in Fian, and we can have the idea of ball motion abnormality of different segment. Because when you will give the stress in dobutamine, so at the high level of the heart rate, like 200 or 180, that segment will be moving less, and we can have idea that patient have ischemic. So stress echocardiography is actually alternative to exercise tolerant test or stress helium scan. The patient who can't perform the, we can judge the ischemic heart disease, stable ischemic heart disease by doing the stress echocardiography. So we can also have the, we have to diagnose different vegetation or masses. We can take the help of echocardiography. This is a classic picture of atrial myxoma. And look, this the big mass is coming from the attack to interatrial septum and prolapsing into mitral valves. So vegetation and masses, whether it's clot or vegetation or atrial myxoma or tremors, are very well picked by the echocardiography. So coming to the different views. So this is the apical four-chamber view, real image. So this is the apical subcostal window. So this is the real scene showing the left peritoneal view. This is the short axis view, and this is the subcostal view. This is apical four-chamber view. You are showing all four chambers. So this is disease valve, their aortic regurgitation. This is AR jet, and this is the mitral stenotic valve. So you have seen already a patient who have left peritoneal view with a normal mitral valve and the Snow's mitral valve. So you can pick the complication also by doing this echocardiography. Complication session will be done inshallah in future. So today was all about the basics of echocardiography. Thank you very much indeed. Any question? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. It was a nice presentation, very informative. We have got a few questions. The first question is from somebody who is not interested to show his or her name, his hidden name. What are the normal results of echocardiogram? Sir, the question is, what are the normal results of echocardiogram?
So echocardiography, although is a good tool for diagnosis of different diseases like ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarction, valvular lesion, stenotic lesion, regurgitant lesion, congenital heart disease defects, but it is totally operator dependent. It depends upon who is performing echo and how experienced he is. But 5 to 10% inter-operator variation. Otherwise, 70 to 80% of the lesions are normally picked by the echocardiography, whether it comes to the structural lesion or the functional lesion. So it's a good modality too. Like if we have to pick the vegetation or masses, transthoracic will pick 60 to 70% of the masses or vegetation or clot. But trans-esophageal echocardiography will pick 90 to 95% of these diseases. It depends upon what modality you are using and for what purpose you are using.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, that is there any preparation required for echocardiographic examination?
Yes, this is a very interesting question and commonly asked by the patients. So for echocardiography, it is just like ultrasound. So for ultrasound, I think Professor Amir is in better position to tell the answer, because some things you need the preparation, especially when we have to comment on the renal artery stenosis. So, but in echocardiography, there is no preparation. Even you can take the breakfast. It's just a 5 to 10 minute scan of the heart, and there's ultrasound. There's a probe, actually ultrasonic probe. There is no hazard of this ultrasound. There is no radiation at all. Even pregnant patient we can do safely, and it's a modality of choice, especially the patient who can't have the other imaging like a CT scan, because we have patient have to be exposed and have to prepare before that. For contrast, we have to give contrast. But for echocardiography, classic transthoracic cardiography, there is no need of contrast, and there is no special preparation, and no need of breakfast. When you have to prepare for the transthoracic echocardiography, yes. So we need preparation. We have to make the patient break fasting for at least 6 hours before that very test. We ask these patients to have fasting for 5 hours before that very test, because the probe have to, we are just doing gastroscopy, and we have to put the probe into the esophagus. We really keep the patient fasting. For echocardiography, there is no need of preparation.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, can we measure the flow velocity at the stenotic valve with the help of pulse wave Doppler?
Pulse wave Doppler, actually, we can measure the left ventricle outflow tract velocity, and we can have the idea of aortic valve area, like A1, V1 is equal to A2, V2. So we have to calculate the left ventricle outflow tract area and velocity, and other velocity will be calculated by that very equation. So, but aortic by 4V square, you know, the pressure gradient is equal to, Bernoulli's equation is equal to 4V square. If we have the idea of velocity by, if patient have stenotically and we have the continuous wave and we have the idea of velocity, by multiplying it by 4, we can have the pressure gradient, idea of pressure gradient. At the same time, we can calculate the aortic valve area also through this.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, can an echocardiogram detect clogged arteries?
Okay, it's indirectly detect the blocked artery. If patient have myocardial infarction, like he landed with the anterior wall MI and ECG, you can have the changes, ST elevation in V1 to V4. Then we would have idea that probably his left anterior descending artery would have been blocked. So when we do echocardiography, we check the different chamber at different level by left peritoneal view and the short axis view at the mid and apical and basal LV level. Then we have the apical 4-chamber with a 2-upper chamber view. So the, in all chamber, the anterior wall will be moving less than as compared to inferior or posterior wall. So by calculating the relatively dysfunctional anterior wall, we can have idea that patient left anterior descending artery is blocked, and that's why that the left anterior descending is supplying the anterior wall. So that's our septum wall. So that anteroseptal wall will be moving less. Indirectly, we can judge that patient left anterior descending artery is blocked. So but for actually confirming it, we can have the angiogram. Angiogram will tell you where vessel is blocked, and what where is the lien, so that will confirm. But echocardiography will give you the indirect view that left anterior descending is the vessel which was involved, which have lead to anterior wall MI. So no, anterior wall is moving less.
Thank you, sir. The next question is, can the next question is, sir, tell us about stress echocardiography.
Stress echocardiography nowadays is a modality which is the least used, because there are other modalities also very well picking the ischemic heart disease, especially ischemic heart disease, stable ischemic heart disease. We people actually perform this echocardiography for stable ischemic heart disease. And you know, exercise tolerance test is equally effective. It gives you 60 to 70% idea of ischemic heart disease. Similarly, stress thallium scan also gives you 80 to 90% idea of ischemic heart disease. By perfusion mismatch, we can have the PET scan, and we also know an era of CT angiogram, which is actually for these patients who are stable ischemic, having stable ischemic heart disease or atypical chest pain. We can have CT angiogram, and we can look the coronary artery blockage, and we can detect how many vessels are blocked and where is the blockage. Huh? Stress echocardiography, yes, stress echocardiography can give you the picture of ischemic heart disease, stable ischemic heart disease, and we can give the patient stress, and we have to increase the heart rate by giving dobutamine or adenosine, or we can ask the patient to have ETT, or then once the heart rate is achieved, then we can take the basic images before heart rate is achieved, and after heart rate is achieved, tachycardia is achieved, target tachycardia achieved, and we look the normal kinesis of the anterior inferior wall before stress and after stress. After stress, that wall will be moving less, so we can have indirect idea that patient have ischemic heart disease. So stress echocardiography is valid tool when their other modalities are contraindicated or patient not accepting their modalities.
Sir, we are left with two questions. The second last question is, do we use gel for transesophageal echocardiography?
Yes, sir. Transthoracic echocardiography, we use plenty of gel because this is the media where your sound waves are transmitted through this. And but for the transesophageal echocardiography, yes, we use gel, but we do not use the gel at the camera. We use the gel for the probe which we actually introduce through the esophagus. Definitely, we use gel for transesophageal echocardiography also.
The last question, sir, is, what is the significance of TTE in coronary artery disease?
Transthoracic echocardiography in coronary artery disease. Definitely, transthoracic echocardiography, ischemic heart disease are very well picked. This basic echocardiography actually is like ECG. So now it is a basic investigation for the patient who of heart diseases. It's actually basic, becoming a basic tool, in fact. So ischemic heart disease, we can calculate, we can differentiate different myocardial infarction, whether it's anterior wall MI, inferior wall MI, infraposterior wall MI, lateral wall MI, right ventricular infarction by doing this echocardiography. Because by doing echocardiography, that segment will be moving less, and we can have idea that coronary artery supply, that segment actually is blocked. That's why that segment is moving less. So we can definitely diagnose ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarction specifically, and cardiomyopathy by doing echocardiography. This is gold standard, in effect.
Thank you very much, sir.
With this, we use angiography. Yes, yes.
Thank you, sir. With this, we finish all the questions we had from the attendees. At the end, I am thankful to our speaker, the Professor Dr. Muzaffar Ali. As I mentioned earlier, he is consultant clinical an interventional cardiologist, associate professor of cardiology at Allama Iqbal Medical College, Jinnah Hospital, Lahore, Pakistan. We will invite him as guest speaker in some of our panel discussions regarding cardiology. And we are going to soon introduce some of the workshops, online workshops for our students. With his expertise, I hope we will be learning a lot. I'm also thankful to the management of the Afro-Asian Institute of Medical Sciences, the team which is organizing all these things and taking care of its streaming on Facebook. Those who are interested, they can visit www.aaims.edu.pk for our free seminars, free webinars, and there are some paid courses. Alhamdulillah, another announcement is there that we are going to arrange Viva sessions, preparatory Viva sessions for FSR with a panel of four examiners from UK, from the Royal College. We are also having a course tomorrow, which is about food safety. That will be regarding international certification, which is going to be introduced in Pakistan. So with this, I'm thankful to all the participants. This recording will be on YouTube within 2 days. Those who attended on Zoom will be getting their certificates, because there were many people who were not attending, but they were coming for 5 to 7 seconds, just writing their names and emails on Facebook, and they were skipping. So for that, to keep the standards and quality, we have decided to issue e-certificates to those who attend. They learn from the experts, and then they get e-certificates. So, sir, thank you very much again, and hope to see you again. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, sir.
Thank you very much indeed. Great learning opportunity. Thank you very much indeed.